and gentlemen, welcome to our communion service on this, the fifth Sunday of Lent. Welcome back, those of you who have the joy of being away on holiday. Welcome back, those of you who have the joy of being allowed out after COVID. Welcome to anybody who's new, and I know that we've got certainly people in that category this morning too. And hopefully nobody's feeling left out. If you're a regular, it's great to see you week by week. Let's pause, I'll give a short prayer and then introduce our opening hymn. Lord Jesus, thank you for the joy and the delight and the privilege of being able to gather together to praise and worship you. We pray that you will meet with each one of us as we seek to worship you in spirit and truth. Meet with us, nourish us, and encourage us. Amen. And our opening hymn, before that, Kate wanted me to let you know that we will be singing the Kyrie to another part, to Dark's setting. It's not a dark communion, it is a light communion, as always, but it's to a setting by a chap called Dark. Do join in the Kyrie if you wish to, with two other parts. You might find easier just to listen to the choir's excellent delivery of those parts of the summer communion service. So having given you that announcement, let's stand and sing to God be the glory, led by our glorious choir.
Through Jesus.
our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all.
And also with you. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth.
Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness,
for they shall be satisfied.
Blessed are the merciful,
for they shall obtain mercy.
Blessed are the pure in heart,
for they shall see God.
Blessed are the peacemakers,
for they shall be called children of God.
Blessed are those who suffer persecution for righteousness' sake.
For theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
And this is where we sing the Kyrie. Gospel calls us to turn away from sin and be faithful to Christ. As we offer ourselves to him in penitence and faith, we renew our confidence and trust in his mercy. Father
eternal, giver of life and grace, we have sinned against you and against our neighbour, in what we have thought, in what we have said, in what we have done. Through ignorance, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We have wounded your love and marred your image in us. We are sorry and ashamed and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and lead us out from darkness to walk as children of light.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Collect for today. Gracious Father, you gave up your Son out of love for the world. Lead us to ponder the mysteries of his passion, that we may know eternal peace through the shedding of our Saviour's blood, Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Now have our readings. Thank you.
Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings forth chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise, they are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Remember not the former things, nor consider the things of old. Behold, I am doing a new thing, now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it? I will make a way in the wilderness, rivers in the desert. The wild beasts will honour me, the jackals and the ostriches. For I give water in the wilderness, rivers in the desert, to give drink to my chosen people, the people whom I formed for myself, that they might declare my praise. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Confidence in the flesh, I, Paul, have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him. Not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have obtained this, or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brethren, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on towards the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gradual hymn, in Christ alone my hope is found. Please stand.
God in hell, this gift of
Said that Jesus loves the poor, and that's right. He cares passionately about the poor and the needy, whether that's financial, material, spiritual, emotional, whatever it is. Jesus cares passionately about those in need. It is also often implied, and sometimes actually said, that because of that, Jesus has no time for the well-off. from our reading from John's Gospel this morning. We hear that Jesus is in Bethany with his friends Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. He's accompanied by his closest disciples, and where they're staying is a house that's big enough to put on a celebratory meal for 14 to 16 at least, to recline around and have space for easy movement beyond where their feet are. They don't sit neatly on chairs around a small or even a medium-sized table. They would have a sort of central area, and then they would sort of stick their bodies out, reclining, a bit like multiple clock arms. So it's quite a big room. You see Jesus with people that he chose to be with when he's not, as it were, working, when he's not on his own praying, when he's not on his own, when he's not with crowds preaching and healing. It looks like the wealthy matter as much as the poor. If we're not still sure that they're wealthy, we're told in verse 3 that Mary has a pound of expensive ointment, pure nard, in an alabaster jar. And in verse 5, Judas helpfully lets us know that it's worth an average year's wages. I looked to find out what the average wage in the UK was last year, and for those of you who what kind of average it is important, this is the median income figure for 2021. £31,000. So some people are on a really good salary. So if the average is £31,000, let us be conservative with regard to an equivalence for that 300 denarii alabaster jar perfume. Let's say it's only worth £25,000. Has anybody here got perfume or ointment at home? On the dressing table or in the bathroom? That's that valuable? Well, there's a shock. Neither are we. So here's Jesus enjoying the company of mixed people in a wealthy setting. And in verse 3, we're told that Mary pours this exceedingly expensive ointment over Jesus' feet, anointing it. Now, cleaning feet, where people didn't have socks, odor eaters, or all those aids which we now have, that was the lowest level job there was. So Mary doing that would have been shocking. But it got worse, because wealthy, well-read, well-behaved women did not have their hair loose in public, because that was an advertising sign for women who, shall we say, whose morals reflected their hair. And it was an advertising sign to men whose morals loosely matched. And yet, here in this civilized, genteel setting, was Mary anointing Jesus, wiping his feet with her loose hair in an expression of great gratitude, deep love, devotion, appreciation, and honouring of Jesus in an extravagant generosity. Her actions reflected what was inside her. Well, Jesus had, after all, given her dead brother Lazarus his life back. He was sitting around, reclining around the table as well. Mary, too, had actually received the life that only Jesus can give. Jesus' actions and his generosity to her and others. Mary did this anointing of Jesus' feet without any prompting, whereas a few days later, in contrast, even after this event, the disciples needed to be taught about foot washing by Jesus. And with what must have been a wry smile, in contrast to Mary's close-up experience of what we might call foot perfume, John tells us that the fragrance of the ointment filled the whole house, and probably for more than just that short time. Everybody benefited, from the greatest to the least, those inside and almost certainly those outside. Everyone's life was improved as a result of Mary's active commitment to Jesus. And the same is true today. Everyone's life gets improved through people's faithful, grateful, obedient, active commitment to Jesus. And yes, there's always one, and in fact often there are several, who can turn sweet honey into bitter vinegar. This time it was Judas. He piped up and, well, surprise, objected. Why wasn't the ointment sold and the money used to help the poor? And of course, we get the same questions today. Why don't we sell the silver that we have? Why doesn't the church sell its property and give the money raised to the poor? Well, maybe as a partial response to this question, let me tell you about a university faculty that, for reasons that will probably become obvious, will remain anonymous. It is an actual event of that happened. They were considering renovating their chapel. They had received a modest proposal from their architect, but would they go ahead? Should they go ahead? And the answer was no. Why? Well, one of the people there said, with all the poverty and hunger in the world, how can we as Christians justify spending £50,000 to pretty up our chapel? Of course, similar objections were not raised when proposals to increase the faculty salaries were put forward. And that figure, that increased figure even, collectively exceeded the £50,000 that was going to be spent on improving the chapel. Nor were objections raised about the luxuriousness and the costs of running the faculty common rooms. In truth, the objections were posturing and a cover for selfishness, maybe even mean-spiritedness, just as it was with Judas. Even so, it is a tough problem. How much should we give to Jesus? How much should we give to others? How much should we reserve for ourselves? Well, Jesus indicates in this gospel reading that the question rests on false dichotomies. That you can either be compassionate to the needy, or you can be devoted to Jesus. That you can't glorify God if the needs of the needy haven't been completely met. He says it is good to glorify God extravagantly. It is right to care for those in all kinds of need. And he tells us that we can be both and do both. However, we do need to guard against what we might call self-righteous religiousness, which can snuff out genuine godly generosity. Paul, writing to the Philippians, as we heard, warns us against self-righteous religiousness, counselling us to look to Jesus for real righteousness, grateful that when we turn to him, we receive his salvation, his life eternal, and receive a share in his righteousness. Elsewhere it's talked on like a robe that we put on ourselves. We're credited, if you like, with Jesus' righteousness. As Christians, our response to Jesus, to his salvation, to his generosity, to giving us life, because we can't earn this eternal life, our response is an active one. We anchor our lives in Jesus, pattern our lives on him, living his way, bringing his healing and wholeness to our town, our communities, our world, meeting needs practically where we are as we do. For us, that's meeting needs within the church community, within our town community, within our county, country, and worldwide. And isn't it an encouragement the way so many people are seeking to help meet the needs of Ukrainian refugees suffering from war and invasion? We also need to avoid mere social activism, which for itself can be a cover for mean-spiritedness and works righteousness, which don't work. And so mere social activism can be divorced from genuine godliness. As Jesus defends Mary and supports her, he challenges those present to be as committed to him as she is, and to be as committed to social action and care as Judas claimed he was. I think we each have those same challenges presented to us. How committed and generous are we in heart and mind and spirit to Jesus? How generous in heart and mind and spirit are we towards fellow disciples? And how generous are we towards the needy? Obviously, this generosity can't be merely financial. It's a generosity of action, time and energy, of heart and mind and spirit. It starts with thinking the better and the best of others and moving on from there. Why? Because Jesus, knowing the worst of us, sought to enable us to become the best that we could be, that we will be when we get to meet him face to face. Some of us can be quick to condemn others who are willing to honour God in bricks and mortar, an analogy to the alabaster jar of perfume. People often suggest that honouring God in physical ways is all about self-aggrandizement. I don't think that that's true. It's a way of expressing honour and glory to God so that others can enjoy worshipping God in beautiful spaces. Some of us can be quick to condemn others because they aren't involved in some aspect of social activism that we are. Maybe even as our own faithfulness, obedience, and worship of Jesus is actually gossamer thin. Some of us actually we can take part in social activism for our own selfish gain, whether financial, Judas, Mr. Skimmer, or reputational. I'm sure in other contexts we've all come across, seen or heard of people who always seem to make a big play of writing a big check publicly with lots of noughts on. Aren't I generous too? Name your charity. It's done, that is, for self-aggrandizement, rather than to thank and honour Jesus. Some people are great examples of this grace, this generosity and commitment to the needy and to Jesus. And to you I say, thank you so much, and please keep it up. You are an honour and a light and an example as you follow and act in your commitment and devotion to Jesus the way Mary did. And let's pause and then let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you for today's example of grateful devotion, extravagant commitment. And we ask that you would transform our hearts, our minds and our spirits, and change our lives, that each of us may be at least a little more extravagant and generous in our devotion to you and our compassion for the needy. May each of us pour out our lives at your feet as perfume pleasing to you, our Saviour, Lord and King, regardless of whether some might suggest we're wasting our lives as we honour and glorify you. Lord Jesus, our King, may we all respond with such gratitude and grace to what you have so extravagantly generously and committedly done for us and done in our lives and in the lives of those around us, that our practical devotion in response to you fills Ledbury with the fragrance of our faith and action. Amen. Would you please stand for the Apostles' Creed? Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again, he ascended into heaven, he is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead.
Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Do please sit or kneel to pray as James said, leads us in our intercession.
Psalm 126, the psalm for today, records the joy of worshippers going up to the temple in Jerusalem following many years of exile in Babylon. And the psalmist writes, "The Lord has done great things for us, and we are filled with joy." Lord, may that be our experience today as we worship together and reflect on your greatness and the blessings you pour out on us daily. Yet, Lord, we feel helpless, angry, heartbroken and troubled by the pain and suffering of the people of Ukraine. Father, how too your heart must ache for the countless hosts of young and old whose lives and homes have been shattered, whose hopes, dreams and futures have evaporated by the constant onslaught of violence, murder and mayhem. Lord, have mercy upon all who suffer. Bring comfort to all displaced peoples and challenge those perpetrators of violence, that convicted of their evil ways may find in you forgiveness and hope. We give thanks for Christian Radio Ministry, FEBC, Ukraine, which has faced significant challenges to stay on air during the Russian invasion. Their senior broadcaster, Pastor Sergei Naku, rejoices that they are able to continue their broadcast throughout the country, with many, many people responding. Praise to you, O Lord. We pray too for Christians here in the UK, and especially in Ledbury, as they plan an active part in the ministry of relief and practical care, and as hearts and homes are open to those in distress. Lord, make us channels of your peace in our homes, our church, our community, and in all circumstances. We also remember the ongoing needs of our mission partners and of so many suffering Christians in the world today. We think especially of our Christian brothers and sisters in Myanmar, North Korea, China, Iran, Nigeria. We've been reminded this morning about the costly worship as Mary, in deep gratitude, anointed Jesus' feet with extravagant perfume. For many in these countries, the cost of worshipping you is very high. Please protect, encourage and comfort your people, that their courage and witness will bring hope and salvation to many. Lord, the reading from Isaiah reminds us not to remember the former things, because you, God, are about to do a new thing, providing a way through the wilderness and refreshing rivers in the desert. Lord, this is a great picture of your loving intervention in world history and in our lives. Help us not to get stuck in the past and long for the old comfortable ways, but to see the new things you want to do here. And so we pray again for the work of LEAF, and especially for suitable premises for our young people. Give Tony Hoyle courage and wisdom as he challenges potential providers and explores ways to meet our young people's needs for a secure base that they can call their own. And we bring to you, Lord, the annual church meeting this Wednesday, that we might see this as an opportunity to discover the new ways you may be leading us into, and give us the courage to listen and to follow you. The Apostle Paul helps us to make it our aim to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. There are important decisions to make. Please give us insights and guidance. And Father, we also bring to you those who are unwell. We especially think of David Kirkham, who was planning to be at church this morning, but he had a fall and was unable to come. We pray for him, and indeed for his dear wife. Loving God, you have promised your special blessing to those who mourn. your comfort to those overwhelmed by grief, your joy to those enduring sorrow. So now we pray for those facing sadness, those burdened with loneliness, those who have lost loved ones and who are striving to come to terms with the emptiness and heartbreak they feel. We pray for those among our families, friends, and in our church community who are facing such times. May all who mourn discover the comfort that you have promised and the strength to face tomorrow. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Would you please stand for the peace? Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who has given access to his grace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Do share a sign of Christ's peace with one another.
Peace with you.
Our next hymn is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
You have to pick. Everything in heaven and on earth is yours.
For all things come from you, and of your own do we give you.
The Lord is here.
His Spirit is with us.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give you thanks and praise.
Do please have a seat. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Saviour. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Virgin Mary. He lived on earth and went about amongst us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us and revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. And now we give you thanks because he was tempted in every way as we are, yet he did not sin. By his grace we are able to triumph over every evil and to live no longer for ourselves alone, but for him who died for us and rose again. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, while praising you and singing. May be to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. We offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom all who share this one bread and this one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever, Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever.
Amen.
As our Saviour taught us, so we pray.
Our Father in heaven,
hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread.
Most merciful Lord,
your love compels us to come in. Our hands were unclean, our hearts were unprepared. We were not fit even to eat the crumbs from under your table. But you, Lord, are the God of our salvation, and share your bread with sinners. So cleanse and lead us with the precious body and blood of your Son, that he may live in us and we in him, and that we, with the whole company of Christ, may sit and eat in your kingdom. Amen.
Before I invite us to the Lord's table to receive communion, I'll just remind you, if you're new, to inform you, we have hand sanitizer. Here we communicate through in both kinds by intention. If you wish to come forward but not receive communion, would like a prayer and blessing, please put your hands like so and I'll know to pray with you. If you prefer to sit in your seat, that's absolutely fine too. Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Blessed are those who are called to his supper.
Lord, I am not worthy to receive you, but only say the word, and I shall be healed.
Thank you. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you have taught us that what we do for the least of our brothers and sisters, we do also for you. And give us the will to be the servant of others, as you were the servant of all, and gave up your life and died for us, that are alive and reign now and forever. Amen. We say together, God of our pilgrimage, you have led us to the living water.
Refresh and sustain us as we go forward on our journey. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. We sing our final hymn, Will You Come and Follow Me? And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always. Amen. Amen. Please have a seat. We have a few notices, and we shall begin with the vows of marriage. I publish the vows of marriage between Lee Francis Critchell and Hayley Elizabeth Kathleen Watson, both single, both of St. Philip's and James Hucklecoat, Gloucester. If any of you know why this man and this woman should not marry legally, please declare it now. And this is for the third time asking. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the love of Lee and Hayley for one another, for their decision to get married, to spend their lives together. We pray that you will bless their preparations, you will watch over them, guard, guide and lead them through their marriage all together. And we pray that you will give them a really great wedding too. Amen.
Amen.
Andrew.
As you've already heard, we have our APCM in here on Wednesday evening at 7 p.m. We have two vacancies for church wardens, as ever, and four for lay representatives of the, on the PCC. Anyone who wants to nominate anyone for church warden would better ask the person being nominated, because they do have to give their agreement. And forms duly have to be duly sort of filled in and signed and handed to Keith by the start of the meeting. For lay representative of the PCC, the same applies, but forms have to be given to me, or left in my pigeonhole at the back of the church. Ideally by the day before, if possible, by Tuesday, so that if we do actually have more nominations than vacancies, we can actually I can actually produce the relevant sort of election forms. Second notice, nothing related to the APCM. I must apologise for the continuing hole in the floor down here and around the south aisle. That the stonemason was expected the week before last, but unfortunately isn't able to get the, all the stone required, the right stone, which comes from Monmouth, but hopefully that will arrive fairly soon and then we can get on with the work. Thank you.
Thank you. A slight correction, I said this was for the third time of asking, this was for the second time of asking Lee and Hayley, you've got another week to go through this.
Good morning. We have enjoyed two very lovely Lent lunches in aid of our mission with Mtwara in Tanzania, and hopefully have raised between £400 and £500. Thank you all very much for all your kind support, and a special thanks to Jan and Ian James, who had a very lovely lunch last Wednesday. So, but if you want to know more about our link with the Father and with the church there, please do look on the notice board over there in the South Isle, because there is an email, a recent email from Father Jackman telling you all about what's happening now. Thank you.
As you can see, we've started to put up some of the Easter Experience Easter stations. If you've offered to help with it, do have a word with me afterwards. Some of the letters have fallen down, but we'll put them up again. The first school is coming on Monday, tomorrow afternoon, and then again the primary school on Thursday and Friday. So if you've said you'd help and you want to help, please have a word with me over coffee afterwards. Thank you.
There we are.
In connection with that, and moving on forwards to Easter itself, the Experience Easter, if you don't know what it is, as Ed said, they're just starting to go up, is a series of interactive prayer stations. They stay up in Holy Week, and that has been an experience that people coming into the church have often enjoyed in the past, being able to go around and interact with those stations and find out a bit more about the real meaning of Easter. So this year, under the auspices of Leith, we are extending our welcome. We're offering a cafe on two of the days in Holy Week. Helen Janssen, thank you very much, is going to run refreshments on the Monday afternoon of Holy Week and on the Tuesday morning of Holy Week. Now, that means we hope that there will be more than the average number of folk coming in to church, not only to enjoy tea and coffee, but also to enjoy interacting with those stations. So if anybody is able to offer just to be here, to be a little bit of an enabler, to be a bit more of a welcomer, than we always have stewards, but a little bit extra, that would be lovely. The other bit of help I'm asking for is a new initiative, because on Easter Saturday, properly called Holy Saturday, I know, not really Easter Saturday, the 16th of April, there will be an Easter egg hunt in Ledbury, across the churches. It's not just about rabbits and bunnies and eggs, it is about the Easter story again, looking for some of the characters and the events of the Easter story. And each of our churches is opening between 10 and 4, and there are things for people to find and a reward of an egg. The schools are going to get leaflets about that this week. So again, I would love to know that we have some folk in church here. I can't do all of it. In between the hours of, sorry Benjamin, I can't do all of it. Rolled his eyes out. Between 10 and 4 on Easter Saturday. I know it's a busy family day, but if you could spare even half an hour just to be here, that'd be lovely. I'm doing coffee today, so please come and tell me. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We prayed, and I'm sure we all continue to think about the Ukraine situation and Ukraine refugees' help. As a church, we are registered with Sanctuary Foundation, an international charity for refugees, and I've been in touch with the diocese, with somebody called Liz Mackay, who's coordinating with the diocese, and we're working with the diocese through and with LEAF, who are Ledbury's single point of contact. So we're actually in two streams, and as Liz said, at the moment things are still incredibly up in the air, and we're all trying to work our way forward. So if things aren't moving as fast as you would wish, pray that the Lord would clear paths to enable people who need help to find that help and for us to match up. This afternoon, William Simmons was due to be licensed to sign a benefice at Little Markle. Turns out that's got to be postponed because Bishop Richard, who tested positive 9 days ago, still seems to be testing positive. So it's William's licensing at Little Markle has been postponed to what is a new, hopefully not provisional, date of Monday, the 11th of April at 7 p.m. That's Monday of Holy Week. Last but by no means least, singers. If any of you out there are singers, and here, of course, you're not excluded from this, self, family and friends, if you'd like to come along and help lead the singing, we've got a Good Friday 2 p.m. Taizé service, and Kate would love people to come and help lead that. Also, Easter Day 10 a.m. Service, if you've got family coming or friends coming who you know would like to sing, have a word with Kate, and you can volunteer then, or yourself for that. And as ever, since February, we are again having coffee and tea and biscuits and chat over in Trinity. So do stay and chat, and if you're new, do make yourself known. Most of us are friendly, and some of us are very friendly. So
some of us might.
Let us now go to serve the Lord. Go in peace.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Squirrel.
You do
okay
to have squirrels.
I am. Yeah.
I'll
I'll try and...
stands we got in the church, which I don't think they do, because I don't think there's a hole in the bottom of them for mounting things.
I don't know, I need to check.
Anyway, would you mind taking this on board? Basically, if they're no use, we need to find a good home for them, ideally with a bit of money, which probably means putting them on the email or something like that. So, over to you if you can see what you can do.
Are they just in the upper room?
Yeah, yeah. There's not much up there now, so they're pretty obvious. So there's a couple of boxes.
There we go.